Hey guys, I'm here. Let's get technical. Did you know that Juno?
Alex, I'm quitting.
Wait, what? Why?
I'm moving.
Where?
Well, Twitter's just alerted me that NASA's discovered 7 Earth-like planets.
I'm leaving. See you in New York.
Wait a sec. You might have heard over the past week or so that NASA's discovered Trappist-1, comprised of a star and 7 new planets. Since it's the largest collection of planets that could have water, just like editing clone, you might have thought.
Well, I'm out of here.
But before you pack up your stuff and leave Earth, let's find out what you're getting into. Here's everything you need to know about Trappist-1. Before I start, it's important to note something. A lot of news outlets have been announcing that Trappist-1 is the name of the star. Now, this does make sense because NASA does recognize Trappist-1 as a nickname, but the official website states that Trappist-1 isn't the formal name of the star, but the name of the entire system. This includes the star and the 7 planets. The star in Trappist-1 is called Trappist-1A, and each of the subsequent planets are called Trappist-1B, Trappist-1C, D, E, F, G, and H. I would make a joke here about how astronomers are terrible at naming things, but it's actually quite logical. I get that people want to be simple, but to clear up confusion, throughout this episode, when I say Trappist-1, I'm referring to the 7 planets and 1 star, and when I say Trappist-1A, I'm referring to just the star. Okay, here we go. Even though NASA held a press conference in DC announcing Trappist-1 on February 22nd, 2017, the first Trappist-1 data was collected on October 3rd, 2013, and all of the data wasn't completely collected and published in the journal Nature until just this month. That's February 2017 for people watching in the future. Trappist-1A is an ultra-cool red dwarf star. What does that mean? Well, there are many different types of stars, and red dwarfs are on the smaller, cooler side. They're so small, in fact, 12 Trappist-1As could fit in our sun. Because they're so small, red dwarf stars last really long. Why? Well, stars work because of nuclear fusion. That's when two atoms crash into each other and the atomic structure of both are altered. In stars, mainly hydrogen collides with other hydrogen and makes helium. This creates a lot of energy and allows stars to burn. And since red dwarf stars are so small, the hydrogen in their core is depleted far slower than other types of stars, allowing them to live for trillions of years. Knowing that, it's probably unsurprising that Trappist-1A is 2.5 times cooler than our sun. In Trappist-1A, there's less nuclear fusion, and thus less heat is produced. Trappist-1, by the way, is named after the telescope that found 2 of the 7 planets. Trappist stands for the Transiting Planets and Planetesimal Small Telescope. It's an ESO telescope in Chile operated by Belgian scientists. NASA's infrared space telescope Spitzer found the other 5. The Trappist-1 planetary system is located in the constellation Aquarius, here in the Milky Way galaxy. It's a clean 39 light years or 12 parsecs away. To give you a sense of how far away that is, imagine walking around the Earth about 9.25 billion times. Yeah, that's the distance. This may seem far, but it's actually pretty close in the grand scheme of things. The Milky Way is about 100,000 light years across, so a little planetary system that's just 39 light years away? That's basically neighbors.
Hey!
And the fact that Trappist-1 is so close makes what I'm about to say even more groundbreaking. Scientists have deduced that all 7 planets could have water, and 3 of them, Trappist-1, E, F, and G, are all in the habitable zone. Ayy! We don't have any actual proof of life on these planets, but it's still astonishing because they are so Earth-like. Speaking of which, how did the scientists find these extraterrestrial bodies? Unfortunately, as you might have guessed, we can't just point a telescope in the sky and see high-def pics of planets and stars 229 trillion miles away. So instead of trying to see the planets, scientists measured the light, or lack of it. Let me explain. 1, 2, 3, let's go! Let's say you're meeting some friends at a park. You and your friends agree to try to meet at noon, but they have a tendency to be late, and you don't exactly know if they're going to be on time. Luckily, you live right next to the park, so close in fact that you can sort of see your designated meeting spot in the distance. You can see if your friends are there and how many of them are there, but your eyes aren't good enough to see any details, so you can't tell which of your friends are there or what they look like. Now, because it's noon and it's pretty sunny and hot out,
okay, well, let's just pretend it's sunny and hot out.
You want to leave your cool air-conditioned house as late as possible, but you don't want to miss anything and be the last one to show up. So, what do you do? Easy. You look, but you don't look to see which of your friends are there, just if they're any there at all, because if they are there, then it's time to leave. And seeing if they're there is pretty simple. It's a sunny day out, so if you see a black figure in the distance, or a blockage of sun, you know there's a human there. And this is exactly how the team of astronomers who found Trappist-1, well, found it. Once they knew where Trappist-1A was, they looked for dips in the total amount of light coming from the star. The planets orbiting the star would block the light, telescopes would pick that up, and the planets were confirmed. Just like how you would confirm that your friends are at the park if they were there blocking light.
Oh, time to go.
So we don't image the individual planets. What we do is the planets pass in front of the star. We see the amount of light that the star is dimmed by when that planet is blocking it. So the dips you see in this animation are the planets going in front of the star, blocking a little bit of the light. The size of the dip tells you the size of the planet, so we can get the size of the planet directly from measuring the dip.
Quick side note here, red dwarfs like Trappist-1A give off a lot of infrared light. A matter of fact, they're thousands of times brighter in infrared than invisible light, which makes them perfect for Spitzer, the telescope that found the majority of the planets, because Spitzer is an infrared telescope. Speaking of which, because of the red dwarf, daylight on Trappist-1 planets would be a reddish-orange. Actually, that's not exactly true, because there isn't a daylight on any of these planets. See, Trappist-1 planets are tidally locked. That means the same half is always day, and the other half is always night. The same side always faces the sun. There's no daylight because it'll never change to night. There's just light and dark. The planets of Trappist-1 are very close to their star. The planets are so close, in fact, it only takes a couple of days for a planet to complete an orbit, sometime between 1.5 and 20 days, depending on the planet. It takes Earth a year, of course. The planets are so close, in fact, all of the orbits could fit in Mercury's orbit and then some. The planets are so close, in fact, that Trappist-1A would appear 6 times larger in the sky of a Trappist-1A planet than our sun does in our sky here on Earth. The 7 planets are very rocky, making them even better for supporting life. Oh, and editing clone?
Yeah.
It would take hundreds of thousands of years to travel to Trappist-1, so don't think that you're going anytime soon.
Man, I had my heart set on exploring new worlds. I wanted to boldly go where no man has gone before.
Wrong person. There we go.
Now, I just can't see the point of it all.
Wait, hold up. This is a YouTube video. I don't want to have the feels, much less witness an emotionally complex character.
Why should I even care?
Ah, that's better. You should care for 3 reasons. 1, alien life. We have 3 strong contenders to find life on a planet other than ours. Granted, it'll probably look pretty different, but with Trappist-1, we are so much closer to finding extraterrestrial life. 2, a future Earth. Earth isn't going to be around forever, and even though this isn't a problem that will affect us or any other human anytime soon, if and when the technology improves, we've got a potential future home. Either that or we'll just go a Wall-E.
Wall-E.
And 3, it's just cool. It's not every day when you find planets that our great, 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 insert more great grandchildren might live on. It's a neat thought. Finally, before we go, what does the future look like? Where will scientists and astronomers go from here? First, astronomers will be searching 1,000 of the closest ultra-cool dwarf stars for other planets that could have water and sustain life. They're calling this Speculoos, which stands for the search for planets eclipsing ultra-cool stars. Does anyone have the heart to tell them that's not how acronyms work? No? Okay, well, I'm not gonna tell them. Second, a lot of scientists have proposed different theories about what it's like on a planet that orbits an ultra-cool red dwarf. This discovery gives them an amazing platform to test all of their hypotheses. Third and finally, the James Webb Space Telescope, or the JWST. See? It's not pretty, but it's how you acronym. Anywho, the JWST is launching in October 2018, and it will allow us to investigate the atmospheres of each of these planets. The JWST can tell us things like which gases are most common, what's the surface temperature, how many greenhouse gases are on each of these planets, and even more. This allows us to learn much more about our neighbors 39 light-years away. Congratulations to the entire team of scientists who made this discovery. This is a truly mind-blowing discovery that I'm definitely honored to have experienced. It'll inspire me as an aspiring astronomer for years to come. If you like what you just saw, subscribe for more. Or if you want to see some more new planet news, check out this video I made a year ago on the then-new mysterious 9th planet. Click right there. I will leave tons of links in the description to more resources. I strongly recommend you check out Trappist-1. It's beautiful and informative and a primary source because it's edited by the Trappist-1 team, so you know it's accurate. Thanks for watching, DFTBA, and explore on.